Lights are on. We're going to get started in just a minute, so I want to invite those of you in the lobby area to come into the theater and take your seats. You can bring the lights down just for a minute.
If you're happy and you know it, then your face will truly show it, even though we can't see you. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. Ta-da, there you go.
Penny Maria, I love you already.
You can tell I'm an educator.
Bring it. Hello, everyone. I'm Lane Sugata, and I was just married 2 weeks, so I'm having fun saying my name out loud. That's what new name. I'm delighted to be here with new theater friends that I am just meeting. Martine Kei Green-Rogers.
Rogers. You got almost there. You were so close.
And I practiced before, and as I butcher things, I hope this beautiful group will correct me. Jocelyn Prince. Hey. PennyMaria Jackson. And Charlique Rolle.
Roll.
Okay.
Yes. You know, I mean.
You can tell we didn't rehearse. We're just getting going. So just as a visual description, I'm a femme white person with blondish hair kind of up in a black jacket and big clear glasses. My pronouns are the they suite. I've spent my life in dance and performance, and I'm currently a senior program officer at the Ford Foundation. I just want to thank, at the jump, American Theater Magazine for hosting this session and inviting us in. This is American Theater's 40th anniversary year. Congratulations. Woo! This is a soft launch for a new writing series that coincides with that 40th anniversary called Theater Futures. And I have some copies here for those lucky few who will grab one. As you have heard on repeat this whole conference, and as you know, American theater stands at a historic crossroads. You've also heard from the very opening plenary, provocations and manifestations for the future. That is what this writing series is about. American Theater has commissioned a number of thinkers to share their visions for our future. And we have essayists here with us today. Four essays are in this summer series that some of you will get today, and then more will roll out throughout the year. We're going to share some ideas with you today, and I want to turn to our group to get us going. I'll also say we want to create plenty of space for you to share your ideas, provocations, to respond to what the speakers are saying, and to help us deepen our thinking. But first, and I want to thank PennyMaria for this suggestion. With Sankofa in mind, let's call our people into the room. Please think about an elder, an ancestor, or a mentor who has shaped your vision for the future. Take just a few seconds to think about that person, and then call their name in the room. This is for everyone.
Patrick J. Sims.
Ron Simmons.
Rodney Ateen Johnson.
Simi Linton. Okay, now, close your eyes. Everyone here on this panel and everyone in the room who feels comfortable doing so, close your eyes and imagine your ideal theater-making ecology. Where are stories being told? What does it smell, sound, and taste like? Now, open your eyes. Can you translate your most hopeful imagination into reality? This is the thought experiment of American Theater Magazine. And I'm going to turn to our panelists to share what they're thinking. What is one specific and actionable item you'd like to share with the room today? And Jocelyn, I'll start with you.
Thank you so much. It's such an honor to be here, and I'm so excited to see so many friends for a long time in this audience. So I've given Lane permission to cut me off if I talk for too long, and I've written out what I'm going to say because I'm very nervous. Okay, so I think it's amazing for four Black women to be sitting here and that American Theater Magazine and the Ford Foundation have chosen to center our voices in this conversation. I think that Black women are uniquely positioned to envision these solutions because we sit at the intersection of race and gender. So we understand how multiple aspects of oppression relate to people's everyday lives. This gives us a strong system about a strong sense of how we can work together to alleviate these pressures in our society. But I also want to point out the irony of the other aspect of this panel structure, which is a structure in which in some ways puts the onus on us as Black women to solve this problem, right? So in the piece that you'll see that American Theater Magazine is publishing, I came up with this metaphor that it feels like someone has woven this complicated web and then asked us to untangle it while blindfolded and under pressure, right? So, because we're also experiencing the oppression as we're doing this work. So I think that cross-sector collaboration should be happening with social justice movements. And I'm talking about social justice organizations that are working in both the nonprofit space and also outside of the nonprofit space. Because we know that we are all working within a nonprofit industrial complex that in itself manifests in a way that oppresses people of color. Thank you. In terms of specificity, I think it's useful to look at Jonathan Kozel's activist work on public education systems in the United States. I highly recommend his 1991 book, Savage Inequalities, Children in American Schools, in which he talks about this deep concern that he has for public school children living in impoverished areas. Schools, and folks who work in arts education understand this in a very deep way, but schools in this country are funded on property taxes, right? So the quality of education, how much money is being invested into your public education is dependent on where you live. right? And we need to make this connection as how it relates to our philanthropic structure as theaters and as theater makers, and how that affects theaters of color. I won't go into it because I feel like I'm out of time, right? Or getting there. So I just want to point out the work of Damali Ayo. So she's a performance conceptual artist, and she created this National Day of Reparations. I don't think it's continuing to go on, but she started in 2003. And in 2007, she talked to The Nation in this really amazing article about how it gets us out of the theoretical and into the practical. So this is a day in which, and people participated in it across the country, you sit on a street corner with a cardboard sign, and you're panhandling money from white people, and you're giving it to black people. Like, and I'm talking about real cash, right? Direct, it's a direct transaction. And I think that that is the core of the idea of reparations that is super simple, right? Uncompensated black genius. Throughout history, the American slavery system, the Jim Crow system, all of these things play into why there's a necessity for reparations. And I think that there's a lot of different steps you can take. There's a lot of different approaches for that. But that is the one idea that I would offer, actionable reparations.
Yeah.
Yes.
Reparations. Thank you. Thank you, Jocelyn, for helping us also think about business models and collaborations, which is one of the themes that's emerging in this writing series. And now, Martine, I'm gonna turn it to you with an invitation to speak about content and form.
Absolutely. So hi, everyone. I'm super excited to be in this space with you all today. So the piece that I wrote, which if you're lucky enough to get your hands on it, it's hot off the presses, is really thinking about, for me, I've always been an artist and an educator. And those things are of equal importance to me. I don't feel like I can be the artist I am without the other piece. And so for that reason, and the other part of my artistry I should mention is I'm a dramaturg by trade. And so, thank you. It lends itself nicely to being in higher ed, but then and also, you know, my job as a theater dramaturg is to question, and then my job as a theater educator is to question. One of my favorite things to say, especially in preparing to write this particular piece, which I promise I'll get to in a second, my favorite thing to say, and I actually just said it to Chris Butler outside, is, you know, the theater is on fire, higher ed is on fire, so guess what these theater higher ed streets look like? And part of the reason why I say it with that kind of passion and fervor is that I recognize that we cannot continue to do things the way we've always done them. Doing them the way we've always done them is the reason why we are where we are. Mm. And so, oh, you don't even need to clap for that. Just wait. Oh, and so part of me is like, okay, Martine, you are a smart, intelligent, amazing human. You can come up with something, right? And the first thing I thought of was like, what if we get back to the basics? Like, where are the places where we remember what it means to experiment, to take risks, etc.? And the next thing you know, I was writing an article about what does it mean to use the scientific method on art. And part of the reason why I'm thinking about that is that, you know, I'm going to ask you to reach back into the Wayback Machine when you're in, like, the fourth grade. But, like, the aspects of the scientific method, if you don't remember, are to question, hypothesis, experiment, observation, analysis, conclusion, and then, depending on what those conclusions look like, rinse and repeat. And part of the reason why I'm thinking about this so much is that I think it's really important for us to remember what it means to experiment, what it means to, that all we don't have to solve all the problems this second, and that we can actually breathe in and take time to figure out what is the real path forward. And part of the reason that I say this, and I want to actually advocate for this, I'll talk about this a little bit more, but I do think one of the best places we can do that is like partnering with your closest educational institution. And part of the reason why I say that is because I know right now is a risky time for theaters. We don't have all the resources that we need in order to do the things that we want to do. But also, we also recognize that we have to do things differently. So where's the place where we can start to experiment? And the stakes are lower. Not saying that they're not high, because you're educating people, but they're lower. And so, you know, I'm going to get into this a little bit more, but just say, like, what if we take the time to question, to hypothesize, to experiment, to observe, to analyze, and conclude in community, but then also with the extensions of our theater community, which includes our theater education community. Make sense? Okay, I'm gonna let it go.
Thanks, we'll Martine. Thanks, Martine. Scientific method, education community, and thank you for the song.
You got it. Anytime. Again.
Penny Maria, I'm gonna turn to you.
Oh, okay.
Audience, and impact.
Yes, audience and impact. And like Jocelyn, I also wrote down my notes because I'm a little nervous. I'm going to go ahead and, as you were saying, just state that. My article is about theaters and cultural orgs committing to the IDEA plans and initiatives that they made, and making sure that our artists and audiences are reflective of the world that we actually live in. So addressing our audience and impact needs lies heavily in our marketing efforts. As a marketer, we need to make the work accessible and remove barriers for non-traditional theater goers. Not only through affordable ticket programs and flexible membership options, but also leaning into empathy. This means finding ways to break down the themes of the plays that we present on our stage and creating many avenues into those stories for various audience segments so that they can find connection points. At Steppenwolf Theater Company, we've recently increased the amount of content we produce around the show, preparing audiences for what they're about to experience on stage, or depending on what the creative teams will allow, sometimes after the show. This includes videos, articles, external press, and then also internal articles where members of our staff interview the artists, social takeovers, audience responses, and so much more. Also, on-site activations can add a lot of value and deepen experiences, not only for current audiences who already visit our spaces, but to some people who may be coming to us for the very first time. For Purpose, our recent world premiere by Brandon Jacobs Jenkins, which was directed by Felicia Rashad, we featured visual art by local Chicagoans in the lobby. We identified artists whose works were perfectly aligned with the story of the play through a collaboration with BACA, Black Arts and Culture Alliance of Chicago. So this goes back to your partnership point. These collaborations ensure that we're reaching the right people, offering more than a discount code or comp tickets, but building relationships. For Sanctuary City by Martina Mayork, which we launched our season with, we collaborated with the Honor Culture Center, a Korean-led space that uplifts local immigrants. We showcased Korean protest banners in the lobby, which were created by local community members turned visual artists. We also offered a panel, allowing space for the Honor Center to share their work and their successes with Steppenwolf audience members. And we also created avenues so that that could be done in person and people could receive information digitally. Also, with tomorrow at the forefront of my mind in conversations and VR field trips with one of my close friends and colleagues, Yayoi Kambada, we've explored ways in which virtual and augmented reality can help audience members experience a moment as a character in an artistic work, stripping away racial, financial, and educational layers that can limit connection or perceived disconnections. Building on audience development and community engagement work of Stephanie Hewley, Baraka Saleh, Linda Walton, Mickey Shepherd, and so many other leaders of the global majority, artistic leaders of the global majority, Donna Walker Kuhn codified these efforts in her book, Invitation to the Party. That was almost 20 years ago, and that text is still relevant today. But the work of these phenomenal Black women can help us welcome in newer audiences in the most authentic way. It's about building.
Thank you, PM. And thank you for the case study for Steppenwolf Theater. And Charlique, I'm going to turn it to you finally. And Charlique asked to be introduced as a human who is focused on creativity in all its forms. Charlique, please.
Yeah. This is really a pleasure to be here. And I will ask you all to just indulge me for a moment and just take a breath with me. So if we just take a big inhale. And exhale. Let's just take one more. Big inhale. And exhale. And that's really my dream for the American theater.
Oh, yes.
That we have a space to simply breathe, to be, to exist. You know, my essay and the things that I was asked to focus on is about economic labor, care for artists. And when we think about even just those two words, economics and labor, they are all based in product over people. Mm-hmm. And whenever we put the product or the thing over the people, it will never be fixed. Mm-hmm. And my hypothesis is that when we start back, right, when we go back to the space of just being a human, not even just being an artist, because I think artistry is core to every human, not just those that are called, that we call ourselves artists. I think that we are all innately artists. We are all innately creative. It just looks different. And we have to shift the perspective and the language of how we communicate that. Because even when we, like, language is so important in that when we define something very specifically, it always causes a chasm. It always causes an us versus them. And when we tear those things apart, then we invite everyone in to be a part of it. So when we start first from the humanistic perspective with our breath, how can we create space for us to breathe, to exist, to be, and a world that says, let's play. How do we get back to a space of play when our art isn't just ticket sales, subscriptions, broken models, boards that don't work, like all of these things, and we get back to the pure joy of what, why we even are in this space, why we're here. For me personally, you know, this year and a lot of my life, there's been a lot of transition, but a lot of it is cultivated around these premises of pursuing peace, cultivating joy, embracing play, stay curious, and rest at all costs. And that is the impetus of how I create, how I work, how I function, how I exist in the world. And what if we, again, got back to that core, first and foremost, and we start to create instead of creating because we are working, we have to, but we create out of a place of abundance, out of a place of rest, mm-hmm. out of a place of healing, and we prioritize the human need and the human care first, and then the labor, which already is a problematic word, but then we addressed the things that we create from that place. Then it shifts how we create. Then we actually have space to imagine. Then we actually have space to build community and not build community for the sake of getting our names on a paper, mm-hmm. of getting some extra funding, of doing this, of all of these other minutia things. But we build community and partnerships from a place that is actually beneficial, sustainable, and has longevity. And it's outside of just our realm, but it is actually how do we build community in the entire society, in all sectors. Because again, arts and culture as a sector is not in isolation. We are not humans in isolation. And when we become more individualistic, then we lose the ability to actually serve each other and build a space that is, that's going to sustain.
Thank you. Thank you, Charlique. Thank you for breath.
Yeah.
Now, I'm just going to popcorn this and invite maybe two of you to jump in. And the question is around, what supports would you need from the theater community to realize your idea? And is there a challenge or provocation that you want to offer to the room?
I got one. That's cool. Here's my challenge. One, trust us. Mm-hmm. And part of the reason why I say that is because, you know, just on a basic level, getting back to my hypothesis, if you are a theater who does not have a sustained, created, organized relationship with your closest higher ed institution, you are missing out on an opportunity. I'm not going to tell you what that opportunity is, because depending on what your organization is and what that organization is, those opportunities could be different, but you are missing out on an opportunity. Trust me when I say that. And for anyone who's in here who's an educator, the reverse applies. If you are an educator in this space and you are not working with theaters in your community, missed opportunity, and also what the ham and cheese sandwich are you waiting for? Seriously.
Thanks, Martine. Is this a burning response? Okay.
Jocelyn. Oh, response to what she said or another idea?
Another idea.
Okay, yeah. I don't know if Carmen Morgan's here at the conference, but she runs Art Equity, and I love the way she says that a lot of times you hear board members say, you know, our theater is not a social justice organization, so we have no role in activist work, right? We hear that all the time. Every theater needs to be a social justice organization. And that's what I wanna see. I don't know if people are reading the news, the political climate is very concerning. This society needs artists, they need us. And all of the tools that we need to create a better world, we have. Like, I'm looking at some of the most genius minds in the American theater right now. Literally, like, Charlie Newell, David Schmitz is extreme. Like, what? Like, we should be able to use the tools that we have. On this very stage, I have seen a galaxy of stars created, right? I've been transported to other times and other places. We as creators know how to, we talk about the world of the play as dramaturgs. We know how to create worlds. We know how to do some of the things that we're talking about as artists. Michael Rowe talks a lot about this. How can we, in the same way that we design a show, design our civic responsibility and our civic participation? We have the tools to do that. So that is my idea, is that all theaters should be social justice organizations, ways of working, ways of knowing. All of that should be focused on societal change.
Mm-hmm. I was just gonna add also
just
that,
go for it.
that my challenge is really to make sure that we don't become complacent. I went to an IDEA workshop with someone before who said, oh, I have friends from different backgrounds, so I don't need to be here. Like, that's not how this works. It's constant, it's ongoing. To bring a little bit of music into it, Erykah Badu, and on, she says, the man that knows something knows that he knows nothing at all. Mm-hmm. And so my challenge is that whatever goal that you reach, whether it's, you know, for one show you have a more diverse audience or your season is more inclusive, like, that's not the end. We have to keep working on building this world for tomorrow.
Okay. Charlique, was there something burning, a challenge for the room?
Yeah, sure. I think, again, reiterating a lot of this partnership expansion and just the impact of our work beyond the stage, in community, through justice work, through humanistic work, is a reminder that, like, we're not in an echo chamber. Mm-hmm. And like Martine said, trust us, trust each other, because it's so easy to isolate ourselves in society, in our work, that we don't actually realize that the solutions are outside of us. We become so insular of, this is the challenge that I am facing, this is the challenge my theater is facing, and we use the words of collaboration, we use the word of partnership, but we don't actually do it. And putting that into action, to really spend time with each other, hearing the needs, and also partnership doesn't mean that you're perfectly aligned. Mm-hmm. That's not real partnership. Partnership is support, regardless of what it is. Because again, if we're only waiting for perfect alignment, then it always is gonna be self-serving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if I could just, so check this out. So one of the things about trust, and one of the things that I think is core about trust, so if you are identify in this room as BIPOC, as someone who is not white, and I know some Latinx people consider themselves white, but if you are BIPOC, raise your hand if you experience racism, microaggressions in your everyday life. Okay, so put your hands down. Raise your hand if in predominantly white institutions, in rehearsal rooms, if you're an artist, in offices, you experience things analogous to what you're experiencing outside of that organization within your organization. So it's analogous, it mirrors those same experiences. Raise your hand if that is true for you. Right? And I know and I hear stories, because part of what my firm does is work with new BIPOC leaders, of bringing these experiences that you're having on a personal level that's affecting your work on a daily basis to leadership, and there's a gaslighting that happens. We don't trust what you're telling us about your personal experience. We don't trust that you know what you're talking about as to how this is related to systemic oppression, right? There's got to be a basic level of trust that white people have for people of color, that we know what we're talking about, not because we read it in a book, because it's our own lived experience. So please stop disagreeing with us when we tell you what is happening in our lives.
Yeah. Trust us. Yeah. Okay. So thank you. Now you've heard ideas and you've heard challenges to the room. I want to just ask you, now that you've heard each other's thoughts, what's surfacing for you? Are there points of synergy that are coming up for you? What's it going to take to implement and move these ideas forward? And I'm going to invite the audience to do the same thing. Anyone want to jump in here?
I'm always happy to do that. I'm just going to always do that. The thing that's interesting to me is that I feel like we are all coming from different vantage points to say the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. There's exact synergy in mm-hmm. what it is. If we do all of the things mm-hmm. that we have talked about, we are already on the path to a better theater future. And so I am excited to be in this space, because the first thing I want to do after we're done is just kiki for a minute to talk about, like, what are the places in which all of the ways that we interact with the theater of the future, where is the synergy? In a very concrete, specific way. Like, how can, for example, me as a dramaturg, or me as someone in higher ed, as an administrator, mm-hmm. I think that's the thing I forgot to mention. I'm a dean. Boop. Mama, look at me now. but like, you know.
DePaul.
Exactly. I guess I should have mentioned that too. I'm the dean of the theater school at DePaul University.
I should have said that.
It's all good. I'm sure people have Googled this by now. But I do wonder, like, where's that space? Because, like, one of the things that I've been thinking about a lot inside of the building is, how do we train our artists of the future to breathe, to remember their worth, that these structures in which they are about to go into don't need to stay that way. How do we make sure that we are being in and of community mm-hmm. at the same time? Because, you know, we all know that, like, the colonizer approach to being going out into community never works for anybody. So, like, how do we, like, there's just so much synergy, I think, mm-hmm. So we should all just have fun. Go get some coffee or tea or something. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Reflections maybe from the other side of the stage.
Yeah, I think about that moment of breath, right? The rest that's so needed. During the pandemic, we all said, we're not going back to working nonstop.
Yeah. And then we did.
And we did exactly that. I mean, you know, financially there's that need, right? But I think about, I think the person who created the NAP ministry, there's a series of cards. And
Trisha
one of them,
Patrick Hersey, okay. Who is a Chicago theater person originally.
Oh, right. Thank you.
And
for
just
that
hosted a nap time this week.
Chicago. Yes. And I have these cards that I gave out at my birthday party last year. Some of you all got some of them. And the one that I kept says, I do nothing alone. My entire life is a collaboration. Mm-hmm. And so sensing what you said, that we have so much in common, and knowing that we can lean on each other's, is very like encouraging. Even like other companies here in Chicago, I call up Maddie Allison at the Goodman all the time, who does audience development, and have conversations there. The way like Marissa Lynn Jones at the League of Chicago Theaters is just really switching up how things used to be, is already leading the way and confirming for us that we need to continue along that path. Yeah. So again, it's not about overworking ourselves and doing too much, but about leaning on and drawing from each other.
Yeah, I have bought and given away so many of the Rest is Resistance books, the Rest
yes.
decks.
Yes.
It is so powerful, and I am not a paid ambassador, so I get no commission, but I highly recommend. Mm-hmm. And one of the cards in the deck says, capitalism cannot have me.
Mm.
And when we remember like the power that we hold yeah. to resist things that do not serve us and serve our communities, that's where the power is. And again, I'm constantly thinking, what does it actually look like to live, lead, and create from a place of rest, first and foremost, as opposed to rest being a dire need? Mm-hmm. Like, rest is something that we can embrace and take part in every day simply because we are human, we are divine, we are in existence. Because we have breath, that is literally the thing that keeps us alive. Scientifically, psychologically, physiologically, mentally, emotionally, all the things. And if we're not creating space for it, we're slowly killing ourselves.
Yeah.
For what? For something we're trying to build that is only changing itself to serve itself and not to serve each other. Mm-hmm. The structures, the systems, we've seen the way technology, theater has advanced, progressed, changed. The one thing that is constant is change. So how do we take care of ourselves to be prepared for change? And I'm always like, you know, like balance, work-life balance, fake news. Like, not at all. But what if we think about the rhythms of life? Because that's the reality. There's the rhythm that it's going to be busy. There's a rhythm that it's going to be a lull. Like, that is the existence. Things are going to change and flow, but we can keep that constant, and rest can exist in all of those spaces. So how do we build that and hold that for each other?
Mm-hmm.
How do we hold that for rest to enable and facilitate freedom, facilitate justice? Because if we don't have what we need to care for ourselves, how can we care for anything else? How can we care for our communities, mm-hmm. for partners, to even think differently? Like, literally, if we're not resting, our brains cannot process information properly.
Mm-hmm.
So we can't even dream and imagine what something could look like differently if we're not resting. And I will like beat that as a dead horse. And it's like, again, rest is a very practical thing, practical and tangible, that leads to all of the solutions that we need.
Thank you, Charlique. And I have just one more question for the group before we invite the audience to respond and dream forward with us. And the question is, and you may have given us your answer here, Charlique, it's about in this moment of such challenge for our sector, how do we dig deep and envision a way forward? How are you doing that? And what advice would you have for those of us in the room who may be struggling? How do you build that muscle of imagination, that muscle of hope? And I'll invite someone other than the dean to jump in first.
I'm not doing it. I'll do it, but not.
Yeah, so it should be a struggle. It is a struggle. The struggle continues. That's just part of it, right? Like, you know, I think that it's important to do things that are new. Try things that are going to make you uncomfortable. Do things that you might, I was talking about disagreement, do things that you might disagree with, right? Or you might not understand. You know, do things that are going to revolutionize the ways in which we've already done things. Don't be afraid to try something that has not been tested. Don't be afraid of that failure. Because right now, what we're doing is failing, like as a collective of the theater ecology. So why not? Let's try to do things differently. I think that one of my favorite examples is what Jacob Padron has done at Long Wharf Theater. They were in a building in New Haven for decades. And Jacob decided that we needed to take theater to the people in the community. So left the building and is now an itinerant company. To a lot of, I think, larger institutions, that's seen as a step backwards, right? When you're itinerant, you gotta expand and you gotta get to a place where you have your own space. That's not necessarily true. And I just wanna say one more thing about that is, yes, like what PennyMaria is saying about non-traditional theater goers, that is true. But that does not mean that people of color don't have theater and other art forms in our own community, mm-hmm. right? It just looks different. Yeah. Breakdancing is an art form, mm-hmm. right? Rapping is an art form. Yes, it is, exactly. Things that are folk art, things that are happening in communities of color and poor communities. Mm-hmm. It's not that we don't appreciate art, we don't understand art, we don't value art. It's that these institutions have made that art in its form inaccessible to people, and people feel disenfranchised and they don't want to participate.
And that's why we need to widen the artists that we bring in, that we bring to the table, why we need to change and expand our staffs to be more inclusive so that these points can get communicated to the people who have the power to allow those shifts to happen. And I'll just add the way forward for me personally. I'm from a Bahamian immigrant family, and there's a lot going on when we think about epigenetics overall. But I draw, for example, from my grandma. What she did was not for her. It was for the next generation, for the generations to come. And when we think about all of those magical moments that we have when we're sitting in a theater, it's like, don't you want your children, your nieces, your nephews, your godchildren, fairy godchildren for me, to experience that, to have that? And that's what fueled me to kind of keep going and trying to change things and make the art survive. Yeah.
Thank you so much. So I think this is the part of the session where we turn to the audience and open up our circle. I wonder maybe we, what do you think, bring the lights up? Can we do that? Look at all the people.
I can see none of you.
If we weren't nervous before, now we can be nervous about who's in the room. So this is your opportunity to share your ideas, what's surfacing for you, to ask for clarification for the ideas that are coming up, to make your offerings of support to build on these ideas, and to know that these ideas are just a few of the many that will come in this series, and that these ideas will need to be updated and to evolve because these are unstable and dynamic times. But this is an invitation to speak up and share your vision. And I have I think I have someone who's gonna take a mic around. Is that possible? Oh, here we go. Can we steal one of the mics?
Yes.
Okay, I see a hand. I saw a hand in the back over there, and maybe we take just a few if we wanna stack.
Thanks so much. Thank you all so very much for those sharing all those wonderful thoughts and ideas. I just have a very direct sort of candid question. How would you, or how have you begun a conversation with, just put it very frankly, wealthy white funders who are the lifeline of our many of our organizations, who themselves are grappling with how to be a part of the solution? How have you started a serious, practical conversations around that?
Thank you for that. And I see another question. Maybe we'll just take a couple.
So I'm going to say something, and I want people to. Oh, sorry. Should I not say that?
Could we just take a couple questions at a time?
100%.
And then we'll turn to you first, Jocelyn. Sorry.
I want to thank the sisters all for your insights and input, and I appreciate it. And I think it was great. But I actually have an answer for the gentleman who just stood up. The way that white foundations, Ford, Mellon, all the rest of them, could actually provide opportunities for this world to come out was stop funding the same fucking white organizations. The reality is our art field, 60% of all arts funding goes to the top 2% of arts organizations in this country. They are amazingly similar in complexion. And we have this week asked for provocations for greater inclusion, greater justice on stage, and equity. And we keep asking it of the same people who don't change behavior. So the best thing for all of y'all in the funding community to do is to give it to people who look like these folks. Give it to the transgender, give it to the black women, give it to the Asian artists, and quit asking white folks to be better than they are. Simple as that.
Thank you for that. And Jocelyn?
Assets for foundations in this country last year were reported at $1.25 trillion. That's how much these foundations have. And so when white donors are crying poverty for, you know, it's like going into communities of color and saying you don't have the $1,000 for the thing that they need when you're representing a $40 million organization or a $1 billion university, right? One of the things I wanted to say in response to that is, you know, Tom Parrish, I don't know if anyone saw this, who's the executive director at Trinity Rep, he got this letter from a major donor, very wealthy, supported the theater, that was complaining about black people, right? Complaining about the diverse programming, riddled with both covert and overt racist statements. Guess what Tom Parrish did? He's a white man. Guess what he did? He gave the money back. He gave the money back. He wrote on social media about what had happened, didn't name names, but he said, you know what? You are not welcome to engage in the theater in this way because you are racist, right? And I think that that should be a qualification for not only board members, but also rich major donors. All money isn't good money, right? And we have to really think about where is this money coming from? Even if we're gonna lose this six-figure gift, what is the cost of taking that gift? What are we inviting into this space? What are we asking workers of color to deal with interacting with these donors and these patrons, right? So I think that that is what I mean by giving up power and privilege. Some people are gonna, there's a spectrum, right? Racism is in the water. But some people are determined to be overtly racist. And you know, there's not too much that you can do about that. And I would suggest that we not invite those people into our space.
Thank you. Any other reflections here, or shall we take more thoughts from the room?
Yeah, I would love to tag on to what Jocelyn just said. I think part of that also is in the same way we think about if you're interviewing for a new job. It's not just you putting yourself to presenting to exist in that environment. You're also interviewing them to see if they align with you. Mm-hmm. And in the same way, you have to ask funders, are they in alignment with the work that we're doing? Because for me, as a former ED of a local theater here in Chicago, my question always was not just how are you funding us, but how are you partnering with us? And not just partnering, but how is our partnership a collaboration of each of our values? And if there is something that is incongruent with the values that you as a funder have identified, then we need to have a conversation, because I'm just asking you a question to partner based off of what you've identified as your values. So either you are a liar or something needs to shift.
Yeah, and I'll add, just stop wasting your energy. When you think about the civil rights movement, all white people were not for that, but there were enough people to come and help us make that change. So there are funders out there, like Ford, asking, what are you doing? How can we move forward, right? Asking the right people for these opinions who will support these investments that are necessary for change to happen. And I think those are the people that you reach out to, that you have these conversations for and move forward with those resources. It's like when you have a marketing campaign, if people aren't buying tickets, I'm going to stop targeting that specific audience and find a new audience who does care. Yeah.
Well, thank you for that. So, you know, I'm trying to decenter myself in this conversation, and it's proving hard, so I want to just name that, you know, as the voice from philanthropy at the table. I feel like I kind of need to respond to what's, you know, being offered here, and the point that was made, who's doing the work, right? And I just want to offer appreciation that philanthropy needs to do work, and to offer my agreement that dollars need to flow into different hands, which is the mission of the Ford Foundation in its present state. You know, I'd offer reflections from our president, Darren Walker, who's taught me that philanthropy at this moment, it's a shift. It's a shift that we need to see from generosity to justice. And what that means is acknowledging the sources of our wealth, where they've come from, and acknowledging our privilege, our institutional privilege and our individual privilege, me as a white person in this, you know, in this panel as well, you know, and what we need to do to shift from generosity to justice is we need to give that privilege up. And that can take different shapes. One of the shapes that it takes is by investing in field leaders, as we did support the Theater Futures series, to share their ideas and to carry those ideas forward. It means, as we think about the decisions that are being made about where dollars are going, situating those most impacted by the decisions in the decision-making process and handing dollars, when possible, you know, over to those artist-led initiatives, right, that are by, for, and with, particularly those serving the cultures and aesthetics of people of color, disability, trans, and gender nonconforming people. That's the work. So I just want to offer that I'm listening, and I'm with you, and I want you to push too. So appreciation. And I want to just now shift to others in the room who may have ideas that you want to bring forward, or questions, anything you like. And I see one hand here, maybe we'll, and another here. Any others that we want to take in a row? And then one up in the corner. So let's take those three and then respond to what we like.
Hey, thanks so much for being here. My name is Cecily, and one of the things that I'm asking, both for me, but also for the people who have access in the room. I'd love to hear from each of you, what was the one thing that made you believe in yourself? Or what was the job, or what was the opportunity that let you know, I have a place, I have a space, I have a voice here, that maybe some folks in the room might not realize they have the power and privilege to offer to other people like you?
Thank you for that. There's one right behind you.
Hello, my name is Ashley Sparks, and my question for you is, how old will you be in 2050? And what conversation?
You don't have to answer that question.
You don't have to answer it out loud. But I want you to think about what's the conversation you hope we are having in 2050.
That's fair.
That sounds like a different series, maybe.
And there was a gentleman in the back, and then we'll let you weigh in on what you like.
Hi, folks. Thank you, first of all, because I feel like you're asking us to stretch beyond our comfort overall, individually, but also society. And also for me, I feel like we have to stretch beyond our borders, both locally and internationally. Mm-hmm. I feel like for me at TCG, always it's exciting to hear that people here focus locally, but we got to look beyond our borders. Mm-hmm. And I feel like to me, the American theater, if it wants to survive, it needs to look beyond its borders, and not just to partner with organizations and countries that are going to bring us funds. Because I feel like a lot of times, like, oh, I want to partner with a European country that's going to tap into this, you know, source of income, but also with organizations and communities where maybe we are the ones with more funds, even when we feel like we don't have that many funds. So just looking beyond borders.
Thank you for that. Thinking beyond our borders. Now there are the questions of access and the question about the conversation down the road. Who'd like to jump in?
I can jump in to respond to some of it. So to your question about feeling empowered, honestly, the first thing that came to mind for me was a job that I had outside of the theater world. And I've shared this with other people. So I don't want to infringe on TCG's nonpartisan policy, but I'm also a Democratic Party activist. My father was a local politician. I grew up working on political campaigns. I've worked on 3 presidential campaigns. The Obama campaign in 2008 that I was on staff for was the first organization to give me a real leadership position. It was not in the theater, and it still continues to be very difficult to take on leadership. You know, and it's not to say that professional politics is some sort of utopia where racism and sexism doesn't exist, but there is a spectrum. And for me, I always encourage, you know, talking to early career folks to try industries outside of theater so that you can compare and get a sense and it gives you a different perspective. I think that is at a detriment to the theater ecology at large that we are not supporting BIPOC leadership. It's not enough just to put someone in a position. You also have to support them as well. I agree with what the gentleman was saying about international collaborations. I think there's 2 good examples of that. I think that what the public has done to support and produce the Belarus Free Theater, the Belarusians who are jailed and tortured for performing theater that is against the state of Belarus, supporting them through the Under the Radar Festival. I would also point to New York Theater Workshop's collaboration with Freedom Theater, which is in Palestine. Real support. You know, I think authentic engagement on the spectrum of things. So I would just offer that.
Thank you. Anyone else? The dean is surprising me.
You took away her mic. Oh.
That was not on purpose. I'm sorry.
You know, I'm okay with giving space to other people. It's fine. To answer the question, which I think is an important question to ask, which is, you know, how did I end up in the space, in the places that I'm in? I have to give, like, 2 very specific shout-outs. One is to Louis Douthit, who used to be, at the time, was at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival, now is at Play On Shakespeare. And part of the reason why is because Louis was one of the first people to hear me. I think, and the reason why I say that is because, like, and I'm going to say something that sounds like I'm patting myself on the back. I promise that's not what it is. But it is very difficult to be a bright, young, black woman in any industry. People will specifically try to trounce you whenever they can. And it was interesting because, like, I met Louis specifically because of someone who I mentioned earlier when we were talking about, like, ancestors. Like, he's still here, but Patrick J. Sims, who was here and actually did a panel with me earlier, he was the one that's like, if I don't get this woman out of this space, she will lose everything that she has to contribute to the theater and to higher ed. And so he was like, let me introduce you to someone who will see you. And it was a life-changing moment to be at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival at that particular moment because I felt like I was doing something that someone cared about. And when I realized that people did care, I just needed to be in the spaces with people that cared, it gave me new energy to keep doing it and finding the people who cared. So I just want to say that because that was a really important moment in my existence as a human, and it's created the monster that I am now.
I'll say that I've had the opportunity to work at prestigious organizations like Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater and the Apollo in New York. But before I got there, I was at a smaller organization called Harlem Stage. That was my first official job in arts administration in New York. And they are actually a launching pad for artists who go to Ailey, who go to Broadway and beyond. And I'm thankful for the person to the person who hired me there, Ivy Newman. And basically one of my responsibilities as a junior marketing associate was to go out to community meetings and drop off postcards. But for me, I was like, that seems kind of wrong. I feel like I should be doing a little more than that. And I went to the Harlem Arts and Culture Committee. And it's like broken up into different sectors based on your neighborhood. So I went to the one that was assigned to our theater, and I made and built real connections with the leaders there. I became a public member on the committee. And so it wasn't just dropping off postcards, but like listening to the folks there, hearing how the theater could better serve them. And even though Harlem Stage is still like relatively small, just a couple of $1 million operating budget, the organization had grown so much so that some folks feel like they weren't in touch with community the way they needed to be. So I was able to help kind of reestablish those lines of communications. And I just felt like, oh my gosh, like I can really make a difference. And so that's what like empowered me to like keep going and keep building. And I met a lot of great mentors and arts professionals as a part of my work on that committee as well. When I think about 2050, I'll be 50.
You didn't have to say that.
Because I'm melanated. I'll look 50 anyway. And I you know, I'm kind of into sci-fi. So I imagine that as these billionaires are trying to figure out how to get to different planets, I'll be one of the people like, so how are we taking the arts here? What performances are we curating? I hope that's we're over all of these other issues that divide us and can focus on performing in the universe.
So. I'm gonna be 50 in outer space with you, Pino.
Yes.
I love that.
Yes.
Yeah. So. Thank you, Cecily, for that question. I've been thinking about that a lot lately. I think about a lot of things. So like Penny Maria, I was born and raised in the Bahamas. So for me, being an artist never really was a well-received choice. Before I graduated high school, my father requested that I find a substantial career. So I went to undergrad as a biochem major and I was going to be an orthodontist. Wow. And within, by the end of my freshman year, I was no longer a bio major. And part of that for me was because even before I went, I had, since I was a child, I knew that art had a healing power on me, and I wanted to create that space for others. And I knew that the arts were a significant part of my own purpose. And moving into, and also because I changed, we made a deal that I would get an MBA. Great. So the thing that I always held in moving in this part of my journey is the conviction of who I am, my own personal mission, and who I feel called to be in any space I walk into. Not what I'm called, not what I want to do, who I am called to be. And that is the thing that I carry with me. So to what Jocelyn said about going into other workplaces, work environments, work sectors, I'm still who I am called to be wherever I go. And I think that the more that I experience that and grounded in that, that is the key, that's what gave me the courage, because it takes a lot of courage to actually see myself in that way. Mm-hmm. Because people can diminish you when they see you as a bright, ambitious, passionate individual and misconstrue your intentions simply by your nature and existence, because the world has jaded how we think about people, and we don't remember that we're just humans. And so when I remember that, that I am created very passionately, I was created with passion, and I am created to be passionate, then I don't have to question how I bring that and how I show up into a space. Because that's no longer my problem if you have an issue with how passionate I show up. So I also did an MBA. I went to seminary. I was in full-time ministry. So all of those things shape how I see and move in the world and how I see our community, how I see the sector, how I see healing and rest and seeing myself through that as well.
This is why you wanted to be introduced as a human.
Yeah.
That's right. Okay, so we're going to take a final round of a few comments, questions, and then turn it to the group for final thoughts. And I see one hand right here, and then another there. And I see, okay, I see three back there. So let's just do all of that. Let's go. Please.
I know. Hi. So my question for you all, I'm sorry, I have a cold. My question for you all is how, as a young Black artist, just this is my first year in the industry. I graduated high school like 3 weeks ago.
Boop.
Yeah.
Thank you. But how do you guys deal with rejection as a Black person? How do you guys deal with the waiting? Because theater is really it's a very big waiting game. How do you guys deal with that? And how do you deal with the passion to do something at the same time when you're waiting and you want to act, you want to create? How do you deal with that while you're in that space?
Thank you. And there was one over there.
Thank you. Hey, my question's actually for Martine. I loved what you mentioned about experimentation, right? And so my question is have you seen or have you heard of work that's being done with that level of intentionality that you're excited about or that you're concerned about? And I think the other the back end of that question is how do we maintain accountability when we are saying we're trying, we're just trying here, that kind of sense. How if we're gonna try something and it doesn't work, where does the accountability still lie with the organizations that are trying these things, right?
And then there were a couple questions right back, or comments up there.
Uh,
gentleman in a green and white striped shirt, I think.
First of all, what's up, y'all? Hey.
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 My question is, how do we stop gatekeeping? I think one thing that's beautiful about this discussion and the conference at large is that we can have this conversation and dream about the future of theater and how we all work together to implement these things. But one thing that I feel like is not really being talked about is that once we leave, there are still many people in any position, mainly at the top, right, who will tell you to reach for the stars, and then when you reach, they're like, yeah, but not that one. Yeah? And so how do we dream? How do we implement? How do we rest while also keeping the access there?
Was there another one? Okay.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for this panel. It's been so wonderful to hear you speak. I just have a bit of an offering for the room. I know this is only a small piece of the puzzle, but in some ways answers your question as one new tool. I work for an organization called Rise Theater. We just turned one, a very young organization, but we partner with the Miranda Family Foundation. RISE stands for Representation, Inclusion, Support for Employment. And it seeks to build a more equitable and inclusive theater industry by centralizing DEIA tools and resources through a network of partners and a national personnel directory that supports and amplifies folks from underrepresented backgrounds, including but not limited to women of color, people of color, women, trans, non-binary, deaf, and disabled theater professionals. And it's just a free directory that it's for anyone besides actors, anyone backstage, all administrators, all designers, all directors. And I just want to offer it as a resource for how we can continue to find local community members who are also looking to make the change and do the work.
Thank you. And was there one more? Or okay, let's take that and then closing thoughts, responses to what we've heard.
Peace, y'all. Thank you. Thank you. I don't know what it is. It's a statement, a question, an invitation, a provocation. But even sort of when I was looking at the conference schedule, I had the question of who is this conference for? This is my first time at TCG. Yeah. I have connections to many institutions, to many of you. And you know, if I'm thinking from my freelance artist hat, it didn't seem like it was for me, right? And so I have this question to you all, to you leaders of these institutions, right, at the executive and artistic director levels, as mid-level administrators, right? How are we bringing freelance artists into the rooms, into these conversations about what the future of our theaters and our organizations look like, right? How are we centering them? I work from a Black queer feminist lens, and critical race theory says, right, the people closest to the issues have the best solutions. And so if at the end of the day, this, you know, the way that the economy is working or isn't working is affecting, drastically impacting those of us who don't have full-time jobs, right, and salaries. How are we making sure that they are in these rooms? And how are we paying them to do that?
Thank you. So thank you for your questions, your provocations here. And I'm just going to turn to our panelists to jump in. It was a rich array of inputs.
Thank you.
The experimentation.
Hello. Team. Yay. Experimentation. Thank you for that question. I appreciate it. So one, basically, we are almost in the sort of end of a 2-year cycle of starting the experiment, like the scientific method inside of DePaul. The question that I had that I came into the position. So for those of you who don't know, I've been at DePaul 2 years now. I just finished my second year. And so when I came in, did some deep listening, and one of the things that I heard was that people were either tired or they were interested in getting out of the building. And so I was like, okay, I can try to tackle both of those. And I got very lucky in that the universe must have heard me say, dear Lord, how do I do this? Because the first thing that happened is that Damon Kiley, who is sitting over there looking very not happy that I just called him out, showed up at my door. He is one of my faculty. He's one of the faculty members at TTS, and he came with an idea about an associate dean position that was specifically in interdisciplinary work and academic innovation. And at least that's what the title ended up becoming. So basically I was like, go forth, find us partners to work with. And he did the most amazingly brilliant job of that. And part of the reason why I'm singing his praises for that is because we are now in this interesting rinse and repeat now of saying, like, we did the question of, you know, well, the question was, for example, why in the year of our goddess 2024 have we not done an official partnership with the School of Cinematic Art at DePaul? And so now, at the end of this two-year cycle, we have just wrapped up filming our first film with the School of Cinematic Art. We'll see what it looks like. I know that Damon made an appearance in it, so we'll also see what he looks like in it. But you know, and now what we are doing really is the observation. So that was the experiment. Now the observation part. Now we are in the moment of like asking the questions, like, should we ever do this again? Was that a good idea? What did we learn from this? What if we're going to do it again? What do we need to do better? And we're literally going to have our postmortem, our reflection on this, like this week. So, you know, and so once we finish doing that, we'll figure out what went well, what didn't go so well, figure out if we want to do it again, and then rinse and repeat if we do. And if we don't, I think the thing that we are all okay with in that space is saying, we can now let this go. We have run the experiment. It didn't quite do what we needed to do. We're going to move forward and look at other things. Or if it does, or if we see that there is a path to make it better so that it does work better for us, and let's try that again. And that's part of the reason why I'm such an advocate for us doing this in spaces of higher ed and saying that you should come partner with us in higher ed, because back to, we can do the rinse and repeat. And we will also do the rinse and repeat with an audience that may or may not remember if it goes terribly wrong and goes down in flames. No, seriously, I mean, within a two-year or four-year cycle, the people who were like, that was the worst thing ever, don't do it again, they will be gone, hopefully. And I'm not saying that in a bad way, I'm just saying they will be gone. So, you know, in the end, you know, and we can talk about this a little bit more, like I would love to connect to talk a little bit more about it, but, you know, I'm also in, you know, dramaturg, data collection, so now the question is, like, once we have that reflection, what do we do, how do we file that and say, okay, now, how do we like either do this again? What is the analysis? What is the conclusion? So we're getting there.
Thanks.
And I have a lot more.
Thanks, Martine. And we have passed time. I'm gonna invite you all to share, respond to what you would like to respond, and I'll bring it to you.
Yeah, mine is super quick. I just made a list. So how do we stop gatekeeping? And this is kind of related to the what is, you know, the theater feel like, smell like. It's, we need to re-envision who is keeping the gate, what is being kept, and why? Like, what does the gate look like? What does it feel like to stand outside of that gate? And just kind of think about how we might reimagine or re-envision what that is. I would say in terms of how to deal with rejection is kind of what I mentioned before. It's find other passions. Find passions in other industries. Are there other things that you're interested in? Even if you didn't learn it in school, you can learn it as anyone does who has a college degree and starts doing something. So I think that diversifying your income, finding other things to do, and not taking things personally. The rejection, 85% of it is not a reflection on you. So that mindset might help you kind of move through those no's that you get.
Yeah. Thanks, Jocelyn. PM?
Basically, to your point, I like to say what God has for me is for me, and whoever your God or Lord may be, right? So maybe there's something, even your ancestors may be saying this is not right for you, and you can't see it at the moment. In hindsight, maybe you will. But life is circular, right? So I don't know that you have to abandon it altogether, but just know if it's not working out right now, that doesn't mean it won't work out in the future. But I encourage you also to like reassess, recalibrate. What are other ends that you can take that might eventually get you to this goal? Also, re-gatekeeping. You know, everyone is not ready. Everyone cannot see the vision that you have sometimes. And so you have to move forward with that in mind. And I encourage you to explore other opportunities, other partnerships, get some mentors to start thinking about things differently.
And freelance artists, I want to say also, like, this is something for me to think about more and like some of the work that I'm doing with audience development and my team. But make sure that you start having conversations with different organizations, different individuals earlier on so that you can be included in the budget process. And that way funds are already built into the season for you to come in and help with, not putting all the onus on you specifically. This is something that institutions should do as well. But if you know there's someone you really want to work with, I encourage you to start having those conversations now.
Thank you. Charlique, close us out.
Sure. So I think I want to hit both of those questions as well, because for me, again, when we think about radical imagination and also the question from earlier about what conversations we're having in 2050, how do we stop gatekeeping? We just do it. For those who've known me or worked with me anywhere, like, the scarcity mentality is unhelpful. Mm-hmm. Hoarding resources, information is unhelpful. And that's what gatekeeping really is. We're hoarding information because we don't think we have enough and that we're the only ones who can benefit from this. And so everything we do is a choice as leaders. And the other part of how the gatekeeping and like who's at the gate, who's at the table, what it is, how are we bringing in? Community and partnership isn't just institution to institution. It's human to human, mm-hmm. community to community, and whatever that means. So let's bring in the individual artists, because again, quite frankly, our industry impacts the individual artists significantly. And is built by individual artists. Some of us only topple into administration because our artistry wasn't doing what it needed to do. So how do we bring the individual artists to identify the needs? Because actually the individual artists also have the closest connection to what is happening in the ground, mm-hmm. on the ground.
Yeah.
So bringing those two things together, and that's the conversations that we should be having, or hopefully the conversations we're not having in 2050 of gatekeeping and where the individual artists are, because we can't pimp out the individual artists to get the work done so we can get money, awards, et cetera, et cetera.
Thank you. Thank you. Please
join
me.
Can I just say one more thing?
Yes.
Sorry. My friend, rejection and waiting are a part of life's process. And when we shift the perspective of those as negative things, then you are in the control. You can take control of how you see things. Because a rejection is only a closed door that is not for you, like PennyMaria said. And the doors that are for you will open. The skills that you develop everywhere will give you what you need to be in the place that you are specifically and uniquely designed for.
And you won't look for those opportunities, they'll call you.
Thank you, thank you. I think those are important lessons for all of us in the moment too, so thank you. Thank you for sharing that. That brings the session to a close. Thank you to our amazing panelists. Thank you to American Theater. I've got some Theater Futures magazines for anyone who wants it. Thank you to the Court Theater for having us. And see you at the plenary. Thanks all.